In this section of the course, we're going to be talking about basics of biology. It's the first installment of the basics of biology, and it'll focus on cell biology, on the cell biological and protein machinery that makes biology tick. First, we're going to talk about embryonic development because everything starts with that fertilized egg. And here it is. There's the sperm going through the membranes and eventually fusing with the egg's cytoplasm to deliver its genetic material into the egg. Now, exactly how the genetic material works here, we're going to talk about later. But I wanted to start here because this is the first cell. Every multicellular organism starts with the so-called zygote, the first cell. And then development, human development, proceeds. It proceeds by cell divisions. The initial cell divisions actually divvy up the material in the egg, in the fertilized egg, more or less equally amongst the first few cells. And here at the 8-cell stage, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, the total volume, the total mass of this embryo here is no different from the total mass of the initial egg. And what I wanted to point out here, and this actually has some relevance to genetic testing, is that you can take this 8-cell embryo and you can pluck off one of the cells and put it into genetic testing to see if there are any major chromosomal abnormalities and then decide whether this in vitro fertilized egg should then be implanted or not. Now, the reason this is amazing is that you can literally take one cell off this embryo and the 7 remaining cells still make a perfectly good human, or mouse, or whichever embryo you're talking about. So at this point, the cells are all kind of equivalent. But soon later, there is going to be some differentiation of outer cells and inner cells, and cell divisions proceed, and at some point make this blastomere. I'm pointing out this inner cell mass here because this is what becomes the embryo. And these cells here are support cells. They are derived from the zygote, but they are just support cells and they're not going to contribute to the eventual organism. So at day 6, the embryo hatches out of its membranous sheath and begins to invade the uterus. So here it's crawling through the uterine lining into the uterus. Development proceeds further, as you can see, more cell divisions. And at this point, the embryo is actually growing. And what I mean by growing is quite specific. Growing is not just cell division. Growing is a cell taking up nutrients, increasing its own volume and its own suite of components, and at some point becoming big enough so that it can undergo cell division. And that process continues. So growth and cell division, often confounded, are actually two fundamentally different processes. So the cells grow and then divide, and the embryo grows. And at this point, you have these cell layers here. This is, of course, all three-dimensional. And I wanted to point out this particular stage here. This is an important stage in the embryo. These two cell layers here begin to interact with one another, and they're going to make a third cell layer. And these are the so-called germ layers. Ectoderm, endoderm, those are the ones that pre-existed. And then there's mesoderm, which is forming by cells migrating into this little cavity here and making this germ layer. Now, the reason I'm going over this is because you can see that way later in organismal development, the derivatives of these germ layers are organs that we're all familiar with. So the ectoderm forms the epidermis, upper skin layers, hair, nails, and so forth, and the entire nervous system. The endoderm makes stomach, gut, digestive system, liver, pancreas, etc. And the mesoderm, The tissue layer that's generated by this process here during embryogenesis makes muscle, bone, the urogenital system, kidneys and gonads, blood, immune system, etc. So all of this stuff is set up very early in embryonic development and then gets, as the embryo develops further, elaborated. And here are some MRIs of early human embryos. So these are days post-fertilization. These are cross-sections. And what you can see, I'll point it out on one of the larger embryos here. So of course, embryo grows. And what you can see is, here's the brain. Here's the spinal cord. These are vertebrae that are developing. The face is over here. The brain is really much larger than the face. And so, of course, later processes reshape that. Here we have the liver. I think that's the liver. And here's the umbilicus. So embryonic growth proceeds. And eventually, one gets a full-grown organism. As I said before, embryonic growth happens via cell divisions. The mother cell grows in volume, and then it divides into daughters. And so we're going to talk about DNA later, but here we have a chromosome, one from mom, one from dad. They get duplicated and then, of course, get segregated into the daughter cells appropriately. And the volume of the material that's inside the cell and inside the nucleus also increases, but then gets divvied up in half. So that's cell growth and division. The earliest divisions in the embryonic growth are symmetric. Basically, you have a mother cell and two daughter cells are essentially interchangeable. Later divisions can be asymmetric. Most cell divisions are symmetric. Later divisions can be asymmetric. And here's an example of an asymmetric cell division. So we have a cell layer here upon which sits a stem cell. And this may be, for example, a stem cell in your gut lining. What makes a stem cell? It's a cell that grows, but when it divides, it makes a cell that's different from it, but it remains a stem cell. So you see how this is the same as that. That's your stem cell. And it has generated a daughter cell that is different from itself. Most pattern formation and differentiation, in other words, where cells become different from their mothers or neighbors and develop into distinct tissues and cell types, is achieved by signaling from other neighboring cells. Okay? So here we have an example of pattern formation and of the signaling. This is, let me start here. This is a human embryo. And you can see that the limb is already beginning to form right here. And in fact, in one of the really fascinating aspects of limb development, you can see that there's still tissue in between the fingers here. And what's happening here is that where there will be fingers, the cells condense and become denser. And in between, there's actually a process called programmed cell death. Because you don't want to have webs between your fingers. And so the cells that sit in between the fingers here at this early stage actually commit suicide. It's programmed. So that's one of the pattern formation mechanisms. Before we get to that point, what happens is that out of the side of the embryo, there is a bulge that forms. And what happens here is that the epidermal layer, remember that's the thin layer on top, secretes a particular protein signal to the underlying mesodermal layer. And that protein signal tells this mesodermal layer to, tells the cells to grow and divide. And that's why that's called the progress zone. So basically, here's a signal coming from the apical ectodermal ridge, signals to the progress zone, and these cells divide. And the division of the cell, of those cells then makes it so that the limb bud grows out and becomes something that's paddle-shaped, and then later on in development becomes that. So that's the proximal distal outgrowth. There are also pattern formation mechanisms that happen here that determine whether you're a thumb or a pinky. Now this area here will become pinky. And that's because there is a signaling center that tells these cells to adopt eventually these kinds of morphological configurations. And that type of signaling is suppressed up here because here's anterior, there's posterior. There's actually a different signaling center that runs right through here and suppresses it here, but allows it there. So these kinds of signaling interactions eventually give rise to pattern formation. And these types of processes where tissues signal to underlying tissues, or there's interactions with signals sending back and forth and subsequent cell division and differentiation, those types of processes go on everywhere in the developing embryo, throughout embryogenesis. There are lots and lots of things that happen that way. You know, the vertebrae are set up that way, everything. Everything happens by pattern formation via cell-cell interactions. Now, let me point out one other thing about symmetric cell divisions or asymmetric cell divisions, because I think this is a relatively important concept. Symmetric cell divisions basically generate an exponentially growing number of similar cells. Now, these similar cells, as I was just talking about, might, of course, differentiate or undergo pattern formation to become different. But initially, they're the same. But this cell will again divide and give rise to two more cells. This cell will give rise to two more cells. And those cells will give rise, et cetera. So this grows exponentially, quadratically. This grows linearly. When you have a stem cell that buds off one after another, each cell division only produces one new cell, and it's not exponential. Unless, of course, that cell goes on to divide symmetrically. So 10 cell divisions like this, one after another, will give rise to 1,000 cells. 10 cell divisions like this will give rise to 10 cells. So when the embryo grows, most of the growth happens via symmetric cell divisions that generate more and more and more cells. Okay. So that's limb pattern formation. I want to give you one more example of pattern formation, which is quite fascinating. So let me go back here real quick. Let's take a cross section like this and look at what's happening here at the back, around the so-called neural epidermis. So these are cell layers. Here is the midline. Out of these structures, your vertebrae and back muscles will form. And overlying this is a layer of epidermis. This is very early in embryogenesis. And it's called the neural plate, because these cells here begin to fold up into the neural tube. And at this point, the tube is not closed yet, but eventually it will close. And at this point, there are cells that are called the neural crest right here that are between the just standard ectoderm and the neural tube. And these neural crest cells here are amazing cells. They actually, they become this, and at some point they will go out and migrate. So for example, the pigment cells in you that are embedded in your skin, they all come from neural crest. Your peripheral nervous system, your touch receptors and your, you know, various non-central nervous system cells that sense things around the body, they all come from the neural crest. So these are migratory cells, and they basically leave and proliferate and differentiate into various different components. Now, here is the neural tube, and that will become your spinal cord, and in the front, anteriorly, become your brain. And these peripheral components here will become vertebrae and muscle. And again, let me point out, this is about genetic testing. when the neural plate doesn't properly close, you have spina bifida. So you have some openings in the end, exposing the central nervous system to the to mesoderm, basically. So these processes have to happen very, very, with high fidelity so that no disease results. And if they don't, then even early processes can result in later disease. Okay, so and then eventually these cells here become neurons of the central nervous system, like I said. So this is another example of pattern formation where cell signaling interactions, in particular the notochord signaling to its cells up above here to do certain things, generate pattern formation. So let's summarize pattern formation. The zygote is the first cell. Cell division of the developing embryo exponentially increases the number of cells. Now, instead of becoming a blob of like cells, cells, depending on their position in that growing organism, send highly specific protein signals to each other to set up the hallmarks of the body plan and to make the main organs, set up the unlogging for the main organs. And that process continues, and further refinement leads to differentiated cell types and tissues. And these differentiated cell types and tissues are the subject of the next segment. Spatial organization of specialized cells. I'll give you a few examples of how that works. Here's a picture of liver tissue. Each one of those black dots is a cell nucleus, and it's stained with a particular stain that stains a particular marker in the cytoplasm, so that appears red. These, I think, may be bile ducts. I'm not entirely sure. But the first impression that you get, of course, is that the cells are densely packed, and they all kind of look alike. After all, the liver is an organ that really it doesn't do particularly interesting things, let's put it that way. It's basically a chemical machine. So all, you know, many of the cells look very much alike and have the same function, in fact. Now, let me just point out before I forget, when you look at cells, usually cells don't have color unless they're specialized pigment cells, or they're red blood cells, where the heme of the blood gives the cell a red or blue, depending on oxidation status, a color. But most cells are really colorless, unless they are stained with specific dyes for visualization. The light microscopy here is low resolution, and the cell cartoons that I'll show later are based on the artist's rendering of electron microscopic images. Now, as we'll be discussing later, there are lots and lots of different types of proteins in the cell, and oftentimes the scientist uses specific stains to stain specific proteins. And those tend to be the proteins that are in large abundance, so that's how you get the histology here. So structure and organization of different cell types and extracellular material we refer to as tissue. And the function of the tissue basically follows the cellular organization and the capabilities of the various cell types. So a slightly more interesting tissue is skin. And here's one of those artist's renderings that's really cartoon form so that we can understand it better. In reality, it looks a little more complicated and a little messier, really. So here's skin. These cells are your keratinocytes. And on top of the keratinocytes is a layer of dead cells that are filled with keratin, a particular structural protein that really has no other function than to provide structural rigidity and some resistance against physical insult. Right here is one of those melanocytes. So this melanocyte is a pigment cell. That's what melanocyte means. That came from the neural crest early on in development. It migrated. Let's say that this is your skin on your front. It actually migrated from the back in the embryo all the way around to the front and embedded itself right there in the, at the base of the epidermis. This gives me the opportunity to just point out that if you hear something oocyte, like melanocyte or keratinocyte or hepatocyte, which is a liver cell, that means it's a specific cell type. So whenever you hear cyte, it means cell. Okay, so we have keratinocytes, melanocytes. Here's a touch receptor cell. When you press, this thing gets compressed, and when it gets compressed, its membrane deforms, and when its membrane deforms, it sends an electric signal to this nerve cell here, this neuron, and that neuron sends that signal to your brain, and then you know that you've touched yourself. And underneath all of this is a mesodermal layer, the dermis. So the way skin works is that cell divisions, continuous symmetric cell divisions, occur here, and that basically pushes this out, and then if you get further away, the cells begin to die, and then they are dead, and so that's why you have skin flakes, because the cells underneath grow and regenerate. Now, of course, this evolved because it's advantageous to keep continually, to continually produce these, otherwise it would deteriorate more quickly. Same concept applies, for example, to your stomach lining. The cells in your stomach lining continually divide and dead cells get sloughed off. So this is a fairly common kind of process to maintain a layer of live cells that, that remains functional. Okay, so that's skin. Still fairly simple. Not that much stuff happening here other than just protection from the environment. Let's look at the eye, the retina. The retina is arguably a simple neuronal processing center. But you'll soon appreciate the complexity as soon as I walk you through this. Here's a histological slice of the retina. You can see that the cells are really, really densely packed and not quite as nicely resolved as in this cartoon here, but this cartoon makes us understand things. So here we have pigment cells. Oh, I should say that this is the inside of the eye and this is towards the lens. Here we have pigment cells, and that's this layer here. The business end, if you will, are rods and cones. Of course, you know about rods and cones. And that's this cell layer here. See how densely they're packed? It's crazy. So the black stuff here are the nuclei, and then these are the photoreceptor segments. The photoreceptors have lots and lots of membrane layers. So this is a cell, one cell, and it has lots of invaginations to increase the amount of membrane surface. And the reason you want to increase the amount of membrane surface is because the photoreceptor protein molecules are in there. And the more surface you have, the more photoreceptor protein molecules you can fit in there. And the more sensitive you are to actually perceiving light. So these are the rods and cones. And then here we have a layer of various neurons, nerve cells, that take signals from the rods and cones and process them. And as you can see, there are also some lateral connections. There's a bit of processing going on in these neurons as well. And actually, just parenthetically, this lateral processing, where you have signals coming from these receptors, basically being integrated with signals coming from those receptors, lead to things like, you know, for example, the ghost that you see when you look into the sun and then look away, or in the on the grid one of those black and white grids where all of a sudden you see these interactions. That's mostly processing in the retina. And light comes in this way. So it's one of those accidents of evolution where light actually has to pass through the neurons that form this processing layer and actually through the cell bodies of the photoreceptor cells. And only gets sensed when it hits the outer segments. So again, this image is stained. Of course, if it were like this in real life, light wouldn't get through, okay? In reality, this is all completely translucent, and the light does get through. And even more remarkably, you actually are capable of seeing a single photon. So a single little photon that originated in a galaxy far, far away. When it hits here, you will actually see that. It's quite remarkable. It's an amazing system. Okay, so this is, you know, more complicated tissue organization. So let's summarize this. Again, organ precursors first arise by pattern formation, by the way the organism is initially set up during early embryogenesis, sort of the rough draft. Further cell proliferation and differentiation into specialized cell types gives rise to functioning organs. Some organs are made of just a small number of cell types. So for example, liver and muscle. Liver is the detoxifying organ, so all the cells have to do more or less the same thing. Muscle, of course, is all about movement, and again, all of the cells in the muscle have to do pretty much the same thing. So there's not very many cell types in those organs. But other organs are complex, and they either have a wide variety of different cell types, like pancreas or kidney, or they have highly specialized subtypes. So if you think about your brain, for example, you might say, okay, brain only has nerve cells. Okay. It also has some supporting cells called glia, and I will show you some of those. So let's say that we have nerve cells and glia. So from one perspective, you could say brain is really a simple organ. It's just neurons and glia. But of course, neurons and even the glia come in incredible array of diversity. So while you have only two cell types, perhaps, the subtypes are highly diverse and specialized. So the nervous system is actually a complex organ. All organs are permeated with blood vessels, oxygen supply and nutrient supply, hormonal signaling, immune monitoring, and of course, waste removal. And as you saw in both the retina and the skin, the spatial organization of the cell types within the tissue often follows the function, not always. In a sense, the retinal organization is sort of a counterexample, in a sense, because those neurons are in the way of the light, right? But still, more often than not, the spatial organization follows function. So that's that about organs and tissues. Now let's move on. Cell biology and protein function. So now we're going to get more towards proteins, and we're going to ask, how do cells work? And how cells do work. Okay. I've shown you a tiny little sliver of this image before, but I like this image because it's beautiful. it's a bunch of cells that are growing in a dish from Henrietta Lacks. You may have heard of HeLa cells. This was a cell line derived from her cancer in the 50s, I believe. And so these cells have been grown in culture in various laboratories around the world, and they've differentiated into various different things. But they're referred to as HeLa cells, and they're easy to grow, and you can study very basic cell biology in these cells. So it's a beautiful picture because it's stained with three stains. Again, blue is DNA. The cyan is so-called tubulin. Those are essentially thick rods of multi-protein complex stretching through the cell, giving the cell particular rigidity as well as assisting in transport. And then red is actin. That's another cytoskeletal component that is a little smaller and is in different places from the tubulin. Now, these cells do not abut each other perfectly. I think this cell here, the cell membrane, would probably run like this, and these cells' membranes would probably not always touch. Again, in the tissue, they would be abutting each other. So HeLa cells are very useful for studying specific intracellular biology, but they don't do anything particularly interesting in terms of interacting with other cells. And so I want to show you the sort of prototypical cell type that interacts with other cells. And you've seen this picture before. Let's look at these various, let's look at neurons, nerve cells, whose job it is to interact with each other, of course, to do information processing. So this cartoon here already shows you a couple of the main features of a neuron. They're the dendrites that receive signals. And then here's the cell body. And then there's the axon that sends signals. So let's blow that up and look at it in detail. The sort of the dominant feature of this picture is, of course, the intracellular organization here with the nucleus and various other organelles. It's not what I want to focus on right now. We'll talk about that later. So ignore this for the moment. Let's just look at how the cell, this neuron, interacts with other cells. So these dendrites here receive signals from other neurons. And they do so at the synapse. At the synapse here, we have neurotransmitter vesicles that get released when there's an electric impulse coming down. They get released, and then protein receptor molecules on the surface of the cell receive those signals and then send signals into the nucleus, or that may also trigger another electrical impulse of this receiving cell. So the synapse is one key component here. We could talk for days about exactly how a synapse works. It's fascinating and amazing. It's of course the subject of great study because, as you might imagine, these neurotransmitters here are also, these receptors are also targets for pharmacological drugs. Synapse is a main feature of a neuron. The other main feature I wanted to point out is these cells here that are called Schwann cells. And what they do is they wrap themselves around the axon. And they have a very tight wrap around the axon. And they're basically insulating material. So that the electric impulse travels faster down the axon. There is a particular physical chemical basis for this that I'm not going to get into, but basically, suffice it to say, if the axon didn't have these cells around it, the electric impulse would probably peter out or be much, much, much slower. In fact, some neurodegenerative diseases are because the interaction between these Schwann cells, or general glia, and the neuron are impaired in some way on a large scale. So these interactions are very, very important beyond just the sort of obvious interaction of neurons signaling to each other. Okay. That was an example for cell interaction. Here's another pretty picture. I can't resist to show it. Again, this is from the nervous system. This is a cell called an astrocyte. Aha, cyte, cell. Astro, star. Looks like a star, doesn't it, of sorts. It's also a type of support cell. It's not exactly like the one I was talking about earlier where the sheath wraps around the axon of the neuron. This is more a sort of... It senses the integrity of the neuron and provides it with nutrients. And you can see there are other nuclei around, and those are the cells that it interacts with. So just to give you a sense of the complexity of each of these particular cells, the human brain has 200 billion of these or thereabouts, I think. In addition to the trillion or so neurons. Okay, now let's look at components within the cell. And I'm sure you've heard the word organelle. Organelles were discovered by microscopy, essentially, and those are structures within the cell that are visible by microscopy. They're essentially super high molecular weight structures that somehow provide compartments where particular biological processes, cell biological processes happen. So let me point out a few of these. Actually, first, let me point out the most basic unit of the cell, which is the plasma membrane. Every cell is enveloped by a plasma membrane, and we're going to look at the chemistry of that in just a moment. But I wanted to mention that multicellular organisms, animal cells, have a cell membrane, but they don't have a cell wall. Bacteria and plants, in addition to having a membrane, also have a cell wall. The two concepts are distinct. The cell wall is, in the case of plants, is of course cellulose and other materials like lignin that provide a physical barrier. But because animals are sort of flexible, they can't have a rigid wall. So everything in terms of cells abutting each other is done via the plasma membrane. And when they really have to be hooked up to one another, there's proteins that reach across the membranes and tie them together. Okay, so that's the plasma membrane. This is the nucleus, which is where DNA is and where gene expression first starts. And we'll talk about gene expression later. Then there's the so-called endoplasmic reticulum. That is where protein synthesis occurs and protein transport begins. Those proteins that need to go to the outside of the cell or into the plasma membrane are shuttled through the Golgi apparatus here, which processes them in various ways and then makes these vesicles that fuse with the plasma membrane and either deliver proteins that are in the vesicle membrane or deliver the cargo to the outside of the cell. So, so for example, peptide hormones are shuttled outside, out of the cell with that mechanism. These little blobs here are mitochondria. I'm sure you've heard of mitochondria. They're the energy factories of the cell. And those are some of the main features. This cell also, for illustration's sake, has a flagellum. That's a proteinaceous rod that can spin. Some cells have this, some cells don't. It can move, like I said, but it sometimes also serves as sort of an antenna, if you will, to sense the environment. Okay, so those are the basic components of the cell. Let's talk about the membrane. Here's an atom scale cartoon of two components of the cell membrane. This here is a so-called phospholipid. That's the main component of a membrane. And the interesting thing about phospholipids is that they have a tail of carbon hydrogen atoms here that is water repellent, hydrophobic. Or conversely, same meaning, different word, lipophilic, fat-loving, okay? So these don't like water at all. And up here is a bunch of polar groups that actually do like water. And so when you put these phospholipids in together with themselves, they begin to arrange like this, where the tails interact with each other and exclude water. And the heads, so to speak, are in the aqueous, in the water solvent environment of either intracellular space or extracellular space. So that's how the cell separates intracellular from extracellular. And in fact, that's how some organelles separate intra-organelle from outside organelle. The other molecule here that I'm showing is, I believe, is that cholesterol? I don't actually know if that's cholesterol, but point being, cholesterol is a fat-loving molecule. It's not particularly polar, and so it inserts into the membrane and changes the fluid dynamics of the membrane. So a larger cartoon of the membrane looks like this, where again you have these, the lipid bilayer, and it organizes itself into a sheath. And then embedded in the lipid bilayer are proteins that that perform essential functions of membrane biology. So this cartoon shows a few that that are a sort of prototypical types of proteins. Here, for example, that's supposed to be a channel that lets some molecule through when it's active, when it's open. This could be a transport channel for example, sugar, for glucose. Or it could be a channel for sodium or potassium ion, which is important for nerve transmission. Here we have an integral membrane protein where this cartoon here is supposed to show that this is a receptor that can bind to other proteins that come in, and then it sends a signal, and then that signal goes into the cell nucleus, etc. So the membrane is chock full of proteins, and in fact what's not shown here is that the plasma membrane has in some places a very distinct organization where certain types of proteins come together to interact with each other. They're called lipid rafts, and there's a bunch of stuff happening in these lipid rafts that have to do with sensing the environment and sending signals into the cell to then tell the cell what to do with that environmental stimulus. So the plasma membrane itself is not just the boring little, you know, hydrophobic sheath around the cell. It's actually a hub, really, for communication with the outside world. Couple of examples for organelles. Let's look at the Golgi apparatus here. I mentioned earlier, that the Golgi apparatus is responsible for transporting proteins outside the cell. And I want to juxtapose this beautiful cartoon picture with the way it actually looks when you look at a electron micrograph. This is perhaps not the best electron micrograph. You will probably find better ones in the literature, and it's kind of tough to see at this resolution on the screen, but you can see these sheets here and some vesicles. It doesn't quite do it justice. In reality, these pictures are, of course, a little messier than that beautiful cartoon, but this is a particularly poor representation, I hate to admit. But regardless, electron micrographs are used to first understand the ultrastructural layout of intracellular compartments, and then various experimentation can actually tell you where things are. And light microscopy, by the way, has gotten much, much better in recent years, and you can actually visualize subcellular components with high-powered light microscopy very nicely these days. Okay, another example for an organelle is the mitochondrion. And what the mitochondrion has, kind of much like the photoreceptor plasma membrane itself, the mitochondrion has lots of membrane cavities to maximize the surface area of the inner membrane. And I'll explain in a moment why that is. So the mitochondrion is the power plant of the cell. It's in charge of breaking down sugars and fats to generate chemical energy with which the cell can power its machines, its proteins. And it actually has a genome. And let me just digress here for a moment, because I think it's one of those really cool things about biology. As you know, we are all products of evolution. And very, very, very early on in the evolution of the animal cell, a symbiosis between two types of animal cells occurred, where one cell, one bacterial cell, was engulfed by another cell and came to live within it. And over the course of evolution, the engulfed cell became the power plant of that cell which engulfed it, and it became a so-called endosymbiont, so a symbiont within. And a billion years of evolution later, we have the mitochondrion. So this is the evolutionary remnant, if you will, of that original endosymbiotic cell. And evolution has transferred most of the genetic information from that original endosymbiotic cell into the nucleus of the larger cell that engulfed it, but not all of it. In fact, the mitochondrion still has a genome. Yeast mitochondria have a genome, human mitochondria have a genome, plant mitochondria have a genome. All eukaryotic cells have mitochondria, and all the mitochondria have genomes. And they are a remnant of the original genome of that original endosymbiont. And again, parenthetically, by the way, this endosymbiosis stuff, it still happens today amongst unicellular organisms. There are endosymbionts that live within endosymbionts that live within larger cells. It's some crazy stuff. I just wanted to riff on that because I think it's one of those really, really fascinating examples of evolution, how things, how things happen by accident, and then when they work, they persist and become refined. So let's look at mitochondrial function. And again, we're going towards proteins because proteins are the machines of the cells, and much of genetic testing has to do with protein function. So here's an example of how proteins function in the inner mitochondrial membrane. Like I said, the mitochondria are the energy factories of the cell, and this is how it works. There is a bunch of chemical reactions that I'm going to show you in a moment that are happening inside the mitochondrial space. This is the inner membrane of the mitochondrion, and that's the outer membrane. And so here's the cell plasma, inner intermembrane space, and then this is the inside of the mitochondrion. So making a long story short, what happens is that a bunch of interactions of the so-called respiratory chain, a bunch of interactions amongst these proteins, transport electrons in such a way that the concentration of hydrogen ions, protons, hydrogen ions, in the inner membrane space is elevated. Parenthetically, the oxygen that we breathe in and that gets distributed across the body to every cell via the bloodstream, that oxygen is the electron acceptor for this respiratory chain, and the oxygen that we breathe in gets converted to water. So we always think if we breathe in oxygen, we breathe out carbon dioxide. But actually, we breathe in oxygen that gets converted into water by this process, and the carbon dioxide we breathe out is actually carbon products that where the oxygen comes from water within us. So it's not the same oxygen molecules that we breathe in and breathe out. But again, the point here being that there are a whole bunch of chemical reactions that I'm going to show you in a moment that increase the hydrogen concentration in the intermembrane space. And when you increase that hydrogen concentration, you get what's called an electrochemical gradient. So you have more here, less here, and that provides the opportunity to drive these guys back in And this protein here, this machine here, which I showed you earlier actually, is a so-called ATP synthase. So the hydrogen atoms go through this thing and then it actually turns, undergoes changes in conformation. And as it turns, it makes out of a phosphate and an adenosine diphosphate, it makes an ATP. And ATP is the chemical energy currency of the cell. So this is how the cell converts these proton gradients into something it can actually use. This is what the cell can use in all kinds of chemical conversion processes. And that's how it's done. So this is what's happening at the inner membrane of mitochondria. Again, it's an example of how various protein machines perform work and do something essential for the cell. Now let's look at this, the citric acid cycle. Because I think while this is an incredibly complicated picture, I think we'll be able to relate to it shortly. So let me walk you through it. This is a set of chemical reactions, a cartoon of a set of chemical reactions that start with glucose. And glucose gets processed by something called glycolysis and converted into, you know, these little molecules here. And what you're seeing here is the carbons and the oxygens, and the little blobs here are hydrogen atoms, okay? So citrate, that's why it's called a citric acid cycle, because it starts with citric acid. Citric acid has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons in this particular chemical configuration. Citrate gets converted multiple steps to aconitate, isocitrate, ketoglutarate, etc. And each of these steps is catalyzed by an enzyme, by a protein machine that catalyzes or facilitates the conversion of these molecules one step to the next. And what happens here, you can see that we lose a water molecule here, and the water molecule is added. There are small molecules that get converted, and here's a hydrogen that gets produced. That's a hydrogen that's going to contribute to the chemical gradient. And so every single one of these steps has a dedicated protein machine that makes these steps happen. And so you go from 6 carbons, at some point you have 5, then you have 4, etc. More steps and more generation of hydrogen. And then once it gets to this point, it gets hooked up to another 2 carbons, makes another 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbon. And that goes around and gives us the hydrogens for the electrochemical gradient that then makes the ATP, the energy of the cell. And like I said, every single one of these steps has an enzyme, a protein machine that catalyzes it in all different kinds of ways. Here's one of them. This may be a little bit tough to see, but basically, let me orient you. This is succinate dehydrogenase. Parts of it sit in the membrane of the mitochondrion. This is the membrane. These are these hydrophobic tails of the lipids, and that's the surface of the lipids here. So this portion of the protein here, which is currently drawn in cartoon form, but we'll get into protein structure so that makes a little more sense. But basically, this is also, you know, thousands of atoms here that are embedded in the membrane that anchor the rest of the protein into the membrane. And this here is the business end of the protein that catalyzes one particular chemical reaction and nothing else. Okay, highly specific. Each protein is highly specific, and each protein is highly individual. You will never see a protein structure that's exactly like this. The other proteins here look different. Okay. Let me finish this up with giving you a broad sense of where we are with this. So you've seen this picture before, I think. Each one of these blobs here is a particular protein, and there's a whole bunch of them put together. The artist put these together. But actually, the atomic structure of these proteins is actually correct. He took a whole bunch of atomic structures and put them together into this cartoon to convey the density, which is quite high. Only about 70% of your cell is water, allowing for diffusion. The rest is mostly protein. Now, protein abundance varies according to function, and I'll try to give you just an analogy here. Let's look at your house, okay? You have one fridge, and you have maybe 1,000 roof tiles. So depending on exactly the function that's required, you have multiple copies of something or only one copy of something. Maybe you have 3 beds, okay, or, 3 sinks. Same in the cell. If you need something at high abundance, then it's made at high abundance. So for example, these rods here, these rods consist of 2 types of protein, alpha tubulin and beta tubulin, and they fit together to make this three-dimensional structure that grows into a really, really sort of big rod. And so tubulin is one of the most abundant proteins in the cell because you just need to have lots of copies of this. So that's protein density and abundance. Structural elements, you have the so-called cytoskeleton, the cell skeleton. Structural elements provide cell and organelle shape. They facilitate cell and organelle movement and intracellular transport. If you need to get one thing from here to over there, structural elements facilitate that. Then, of course, there's lots of metabolism functions, such as what I was just describing about the respiratory chain. So, for example, that's breakdown of molecules for energy generation. That's breakdown or catabolism. And then synthesis of small molecules that often serve as protein cofactors. That's anabolism, I suppose. Detoxification. And then there's actually trash collection and protein degradation and other degradation as well. Beyond the cytosol, we have lots and lots of functions that proteins engage in. And basically, you can go to Wikipedia and just look at all the cell types that exist in the human body. And, each cell type has a particular function. And beyond the cytosol, these functions are often encoded in these particular places and facilities. So we have membrane functions, small molecule transport, and membrane potential. That's the electrical difference between the outside of the cell and the inside of the cell. That's super important. That keeps the cell alive, actually. Then we have genome functions, which we'll talk about a lot. It's DNA replication and repair and gene expression. Immunity, fighting off infection. Cell death. Remember the example I gave about the cells that die in between the developing fingers? And of course, cell death is another important aspect in our body's physiology, in the sense that when something goes awfully wrong with a cell, it commits suicide so that it doesn't become cancer. And we'll talk about that as well. And then we have a bunch of physiology, cell-cell communication, hormones, oxygen, nutrient transport, the list goes on. And for all of these things, you have specific protein machines that do all that stuff. Finally, beyond the complexity of the physical organization, I wanted to also give you a sense of the time that the chemistry in our cells takes. And the bottom line is that stuff happens really, really, really quickly. So here's just a list of everything that happens. It's not even a complete list. It's just sort of the hallmarks. Everything happens when we perceive light. And as you know that when I'm talking here and you're watching this, we perceive this as real time, right? So in real time, quote unquote, this is all the stuff that happens. Photon hits the receptor, retinol, which is a small molecule bound to rhodopsin, is your vitamin A here, that is hit by the photon. Rhodopsin is bound, retinol is bound to rhodopsin, so the photon hits it. Then retinol, the small molecule, changes shape. And as a result, rhodopsin, the protein that has it, also changes shape. The change shape triggers another change shape in another protein called transducin. The transducin changes a small molecule. Small molecule changes the ion flow on the membrane in a protein channel, leading to an electric impulse. The electric impulse, and this is now we're here, okay? The electric impulse leads to shape changes in proteins at the synapse, so that vesicles that contain neurotransmitter are released. When the neurotransmitter is released, then it binds receptors on the other cell, on the receiving cell. The receptors undergo shape changes, trigger an electric impulse. Multiple steps of these processes go on, first in the processing center beyond your eye, first in the retina, then beyond your eye, and then it finally goes into your brain, where further processes make you understand the whole thing. And so this is literally a chain of hundreds of individual molecular steps, some of which are electric, some of which are literally chemical conversions, and some of which are just protein shape changes. And they happen so quickly that we perceive all of this in real time. So that's the chemistry of biology, if you will. It just goes really, really fast. So let's summarize cell biology. Cells are compartmentalized, both from each other and within into subcellular compartments by phospholipid bilayer membranes. Plasma membrane controls communication and nutrient exchange with neighboring cells via lots of specific transmembrane or integral membrane proteins. Subcellular compartments have distinct functions. For example, the nucleus has DNA, gene expression, endoplasmic reticulum, and Golgi does protein synthesis and secretion. Mitochondria do energy generation. The cytosol does protein synthesis and general metabolism. And this point here is also an interesting one, and this is where the analogy with a town and a house and all that sort of thing again breaks down. Cells make their own protein machinery. They don't import protein machinery from neighboring cells as a general rule. Pretty much everything that happens within a cell is synthesized within a cell. The protein density in the cell and on the membranes is very high. And diffusion and most chemical reactions are very, very fast. With respect to proteins, proteins do almost everything. The diversity is staggering. So we have probably about 15,000 types of protein in our bodies. And an average cell contains about 10,000 of those types. But there is considerable elaboration of the types into subtypes by mechanisms that we'll talk about later. And so this is just sort of the broad categories. And then fine-tuning, I think that goes into the hundreds of thousands. Yeah, probably hundreds of thousands. So hundreds of thousands of different proteins once they've been modified in various ways. so many proteins have many subtypes. Housekeeping proteins, that's what people refer to. Housekeeping is, you know, the stuff that every cell needs to do. Housekeeping proteins are present in every cell type and perform universal functions. So for example, the proteins that are in the mitochondrial inner membrane, they're in every cell. Tubulins, the ones that provide the struts, they're in every cell. Actin is in every cell. The machinery that makes proteins and RNA, DNA, that's present in every cell. So those are housekeeping proteins. Specialized proteins are present only in those cell types where they are needed. So for example, tropomyosin, it's a component of muscle, that's only in muscle. Detox enzymes are only in the liver. Hemoglobin is only in red blood cells, etc. The abundance of proteins varies tremendously amongst proteins. So actin and tubulin, those two cytoskeletal components I was talking about earlier, there's literally thousands of copies in every cell. Most proteins are present in tens to hundreds of copies. And I tried to think of an example of a protein that's only present in one copy, and I couldn't come up with one, but maybe that's a good Google search for you to do. Now, estimates of the total number of protein copies per average human cell vary from about 1 to 5 billion. So just to put that into perspective once again, if one cell contains 5 billion protein molecules and we have 100 trillion cells in our body, that's a very large number. And so that was a really quick run through the basics of cell biology. Some of the fundamental concepts of cell biology. And the next segment will delve into specifics about proteins. And I'll see you then.